Okay, the next item of business is debate on delivering economic transformation, Scotland's inward investment and export growth plans. I'd invite members who wish to participate in the debate to speak to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Ivan McKee to open the debate. Minister, for around 11 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland is an outward-facing nation. We take our place in the world very seriously and work hard to build our links with international partners. And that is true, very much so, in the field of our internationalisation of our economy. And the Scottish Government takes that internationalisation very seriously. That's why we published 3 years ago our export growth plan, and that's why we published 2 years ago our inward investment plan. And both of those plans are evidence-led, they're action-focused. They answer the hard questions around where the Scottish Government should place its resources to maximise returns. And those plans, Presiding Officer, are delivering results. I will come on to talk about those results in a minute, but that is why we have published updates on the plans at this point in time, to make members aware of the actions that we are taking to deliver on the actions and the plans, and to make them aware of the results that are being delivered as a consequence. Presiding Officer, it's very true to say that we have faced more than our fair share of challenges over the last number of years. We have had the challenge of Brexit and the impact that that's had on businesses, on business growth, on businesses' ability to export. We've had the challenges of the COVID pandemic, and currently we're going through a cost crisis and the energy price crisis as a consequence of events that we're aware of. Despite that, the export growth plan and the inward investment plan have been delivering results. And I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Team Scotland for the work that they've put in to make sure that the plan has plans have delivered. I want to talk a bit about, first of all, exports. And if we look at non-oil and gas exports, we're seeing those over recent years growing at twice the rate in Scotland than they are across the rest of the UK. Last year, those exports in Scotland were up 5.7%, while the UK number was down 2.9% compared to the same period 2 years previously. And Scotland is the only part of the UK that can boast a positive balance of trade in goods at plus £2.2 billion compared to a deficit across the rest of the UK. And looking at inward investment, the EY results, the gold standard in terms of results around how inward investment is compared, were published earlier this year. They show Scotland increasing by 14% compared to an increase across the rest of the UK of 2% and across Europe of 5%. So, 1 minute. They show that Scotland is cementing its position as the leading part of the UK for attracting inward investment outside of London. They show that 122 projects were attracted into Scotland, creating almost 8,000 jobs. They show that benefit is happening all across Scotland, with Edinburgh being the number one city in the UK, Glasgow in fourth place, Aberdeen in joint eighth, and Dundee and Livingston also making it into the top 20. So five Scottish locations in the top 20 across the UK. And we're also seeing an increase in the percentage of investors that see Scotland as the most attractive part of the UK, increased from 7% of investors to almost 16% of investors, according to the EY results. Happily take the member's intervention.
Daniel Johnson.
And I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving me. The EY is a well-known survey, but it largely focuses on the number of projects. An alternative survey conducted by CBER, which looks at GVA, shows Scotland behind regions such as the Midlands and the North West. I'm just wondering what work the Scottish Government has done to look at GVA and what can be done to improve our position against those regions of the UK.
Minister.
It's a very good point, and if the members read the report, the original inward investment plan shaping Scotland's economy, you'll recognise that we put considerable analysis onto the understanding spillover benefits. We recognised in that case East of Scotland leading, East of England being the leading part of the UK with regards to maximising spillover benefits. We did some considerable analysis on what we would the additional benefit to Scotland's economy were we to emulate their performance as opposed to being average with the rest rest of the UK. And a big focus of the plan is to deliver on those benefits. And work is underway to further analyse that. I appreciate that that is not as easy to analyse as some other data, but we're very conscious of that and very focused on that, maximising those spillover benefits and spreading those benefits right across the whole country. But as the member recognises, the EY report is very clear in terms of what's been measured, that in terms of Project Scotland is significantly outperforming most other parts of the rest of the UK. I think, Presiding Officer, that demonstrates the clarity of having a very focused strategy, an evidence-based strategy, and coordinating right across Team Scotland to deliver on that consistent message to investors over a number of years is what is delivering those results. Those results, Presiding Officer, didn't happen by accident. I want to, please...
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Minister, for giving way. I recognise the headline figures that he describes about foreign direct investment. Does the Minister also recognise, however, that all foreign direct investment projects aren't created equal and that there are developmental projects and dependency projects? And is the Government investigating whether these projects are actually adding value to the Scottish economy or actually taking Scottish economic sovereignty out of the country?
Minister.
Yes, of course, I understand that, and I'll come on and talk about the approach within the Inward Investment Plan as to how it focuses on maximising values alignment between what we're trying to achieve and what inward investors are trying to achieve to the benefit of Scotland's economy. The Export Plan focused very much on answering four key questions. Which market should we focus on? And it was very clear on our top tier 15 and our second tier of 11 international markets to focus on. Which sector should we prioritise? How we support small, large and medium-sized businesses through a smart segmentation process, which has been delivered to great effect, and how we mobilise Team Scotland, be it SDI and their specialists in market, be it our Global Scots network, our trade envoys, our universities, alumni, the whole of Team Scotland internationally to deliver on that plan. The Inward Investment Plan was about understanding where global opportunity, where the flows of FDI met Scotland's strengths, and we identified 9 subsectors where Scotland delivered those strengths, and we focused down on making sure that those were the opportunity areas we went after. And I think that clarity has delivered those results. We had a very clear focus on the regional impact of those results. And as I mentioned earlier, we are seeing benefits as a consequence right across Scotland, including in rural areas and elsewhere. And many of the examples in the update that's published today are of businesses that have invested in rural parts of Scotland. We focused on the spillover benefits, and I've already mentioned the impact of that. But very importantly, values were absolutely central to our inward investment plan. We look for inward investors that share our values on net zero, on the wellbeing economy, on delivering living wage jobs as a minimum. Very often those jobs are very high paying jobs, and businesses that are focused on the transition to net zero that we are focused on delivering. So I think, and that aligns very much with our vision for trade. So the work we've done there, I think, answers the member's point that we absolutely recognise there's different types of foreign investment. That's why we proactively go and work with investors who we know share our values. Member.
Willie Rennie.
On that point, and we're almost halfway through his contribution today, and he's not mentioned the very alarming and troubling situation with the GFG Alliance at the Lanarkshire Steel Mills and the Labour Smelter. Will we be addressing that in his contribution? Because I think everybody would like to hear what the government's response is to this situation.
Minister.
Thanks for the point, and I know that Willie Rennie never misses the opportunity to raise this issue, and I never miss the opportunity to put him right on the situation with GFG, so I'll take a few seconds to answer on that. But first of all, with regards to his point about the publication of the documents, I think it was yourself that raised that point earlier. I would have been happier to have had those documents out earlier, but I'm informed that parliamentary procedure is such that when we're having a debate on something, the documents can only be published shortly before the debate, but I'm delighted to take as many opportunities as member want to debate this issue and to share the information with members and to meet members in any forum they like to discuss this. With regards to GFG, I'll make the point very, very clearly. The smelter is still there. It's still employing people. It's increasing the number of people that are employed. The Scottish Government, no payments have been missed that are due to the Scottish Government, and the Scottish Government's liabilities as a consequence of the deal are more than covered by the assets the Scottish Government has a call on. So we see that as progress, and I know the member would rather rather the place had shut 6 years ago, but that is not the business we're in. We're in the business of saving jobs as a consequence. And one further point I want to make, I need to make some progress, I've only got 2 minutes left. One further point I want to make is very important, is that we see inward investment has been very much complementary to building Indigenous supply chains, building those clusters that maximise Scotland's economic impact in our key sectors. And we see very much that inward investment being attracted is good for Scottish businesses. It gives them more opportunity, more access to global talent, technology and markets, and builds those clusters that position Scotland's businesses at the forefront of those global technologies. Very quickly, because I'm running out of time.
Thank you. Jamie Huckle-Johnson.
Thanks to the Minister for taking the intervention. It was actually on the point, Willie Rennie. Do you have any concern over some of the reports in the newspapers with regards to GFG, Lochaber and Dalziel?
Minister.
We engage very frequently with our advisers on this. We engage very frequently with GFG Alliance on this. We understand the challenges they're going through, and we're very, very focused on making sure we maximise the value for the Scottish economy as a consequence. And I'll put the member back to what I said before. Is he arguing that we should have allowed that smelter to close? If that's what he's saying, then I think his constituents wouldn't be very happy about that. We've delivered for the economy, for the people of Scotland. But I need to carry on, please, and make some points here. I want to talk very briefly about businesses that are covered in the reports we've issued today. There are many examples of businesses that have maximised their export potential as a consequence of working with SDI, Scottish Government and the whole of Team Scotland to deliver on the actions in the plan. And likewise, inward investors have had significant confidence in Scotland as a result of what we've displayed within those plans, the communication we've had them, the ministerial engagement we've had with them, and the work that's happened to build strong relationships with those investors. Worth noting that 70% of inward investment over the recent period has been a repeat inward investment from investors that are already here and have strong confidence in the Scottish economy. This morning I visited the Tartan Blanket Company down in Leith, and those who haven't been there, it's very well worth a visit. A business that's grown from a start-up to now turning over £5 million, growing at 50 to 60% per year, and most of that business is export, and it's a hugely encouraging success story that we've been delighted to support. I recently visited DSM down in Dalry, who have chosen to invest £100 million in their methane reductive additive to be the manufacturing, global manufacturing centre for that, because of their confidence in the Scottish economy and their ability to deliver what they need to do on the global stage. Presiding officer, there's a whole list of things I could go through in terms of the specific actions we've taken and what we've delivered on. Those are in the report for members to read. I could also spend considerable time going through the actions that we're still working on that will further strengthen our export and inward investment performance. Those are also in the reports for members to read. We will continue to deliver on those plans. I will continue to engage with officials on a monthly basis and with our agencies to make sure we're completely focused on delivering on those plans. And I think what this demonstrates, as one final comment, is the strength of Scotland's economy, what Scotland has got to offer the world in some key technology sectors of the future. Across those key sectors, across all regions of Scotland, to realise the full potential of Scotland's economy and do better, even better than we've done so far, Scotland needs the full powers of all economic levers and the full powers of independence. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. I can advise the Chamber we have no time in hand. Therefore, your interventions will have to be accommodated in your speaking allowance. And with that, I call Liz Smith for 7 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I add my concerns to those expressed by Willie Rennie? Because, Minister, we did not really receive these documents in good time. There was something that came out last night, but the two that have been published today came out with very little time for us to consider them, and particularly in a debate where there is actually no motion, and therefore there is no guidance as to... Yes, of course.
Minister.
Thanks very much. Yeah, I say, I'll be honest with you, I asked that these be published as soon as possible. I think they're a great news story, and I would love members to have as long as they could have to review this. We were advised that parliamentary protocol was such that if we're debating something, then we can only publish it shortly before the debate starts. If that's incorrect, then I would be delighted to take that on board and talk to the relevant officials. But that's the advice we had from parliamentary business according to parliamentary protocol.
Liz Smith.
Thank you, Minister. As a former Chief Whip who attended Bura, I don't think that's quite accurate, if you don't mind me saying. But I do think there's an issue about a debate happening on important, and let's be honest, there's some good news in this, on a debate where we don't have a motion and therefore we don't have any ability to amend anything. And that slightly constrains some of the material that we may use.
Minister.
Is because we're still in the morning period, and as a consequence, we've been advised that a motion can't be put forward. And again, if that's incorrect, I'm happy to be corrected, but that's advice we've had on protocol.
Well, I think there is some substance to debate in this, so we'll leave it there. The Minister has spelt out this afternoon that amongst all the gloom of the current economic forecast, there is at least some good news for Scotland, both in terms of the trends that he's mentioned with inward investment and within exports. And that is good news, and I think we should acknowledge that. Most especially that when it comes to the EY measurements, Scotland is performing well, just behind London, when it comes to attractiveness for inward investment, outpacing growth in the UK economy and many other nations. And it's good to see Edinburgh, Glasgow and Aberdeen functioning well. But I think Daniel Johnson made a good point in his intervention, namely this is about qualitative changes as well as the quantitative ones. And I think that, you know, we have to look at what the outcomes are of some of these decisions. I mean, it is extremely welcome news that, you know, 4,400 inward investment jobs were delivered in 2020-2021, and that's on top of the 4,408 new jobs created by foreign direct investment, most especially in things like engineering and electronics. But I think that there are some qualitative judgments to be made, and perhaps the Minister can come back in his summing up on that. The Minister's been open prior to this debate too about the fact that the Scottish Government's intention is to increase the value of Scottish international exports to 25% of GDP by 2029. And whilst there's still an awful lot of work to do, there are also some encouraging signs, particularly in things like chemicals, some manufactured goods and financial services. So I think, you know, that's helpful. But I think one of the concerns I have is that if you look at the latest business polling, two-thirds of exporting businesses are relatively optimistic about the trade, but there's another third who are much less confident, in fact, in some cases, very pessimistic, given the ongoing supply chain disruptions that they're facing as a result of the war in Ukraine and, of course, the tail end of the pandemic. And I'll come back to that third in a minute, because I think they've got some extremely important pieces of advice for both our governments. So while the Minister is absolutely right to identify the good news, and I'm not going to counteract that, I think we do have to set this in the context of the wider economic forecast. And we've debated this many times already in the past months. That, you know, the Scottish Fiscal Commission for many months now has been highlighting a lot of the weaknesses in the Scottish economy. And some of these are inherent within the UK economy too. But I do think, I come back to it again, I think this issue of weak productivity within the Scottish economy is very serious. And when you put that together with lots of the demographic issues, which tell us in the next 50 years that population in Scotland is likely to fall by 16%, with an emphasis on the problems of the shrinking working population, that makes for very difficult circumstances for us all. And I think the long and short is that much more needs to be done to ensure that Scotland is a much more attractive place in which to live and work, as well as in which to invest. And I think that's the bigger picture that we need to pay attention to, because that's the very strong message that's coming from business and industry. As well as investment incentives, we obviously need tax incentives, a better environment for innovation and skills. Because if we don't have these in place, the rest of our endeavours to take full advantage of the improving performance around inward investment and exports will actually fall short. So let me address just a few of the issues before we move on to some of the more detailed comments that I know my colleagues will make. Without any doubt, business is asking us time and time again for an assurance that our two governments will be working together, not against each other. Because they see that when it comes to effective cooperation, whether that's in things like city deals and free ports and some of the infrastructure projects, that cooperation has worked well and it needs to be enhanced, particularly, dare I say, in light of a lot of the cost of living situation. And it's also the case that the businesses must have as much certainty as possible in these difficult times. And that's just one of the reasons why previously we've been asking the Scottish Government to match the UK Government's pledge to reduce income tax from 20p to 19p in 2024. Because obviously that has a knock-on effect to the block grant adjustment and all sorts of other issues with regard to the tax take. And I think when I read the detail of the medium-term financial strategy, there was a slightly worrying hint there that there could be an increase in the business rate at some stage. And that is something that's causing the business community real concern, because they too are pointing to the productivity trends and demands that we have to do an awful lot more in business to support them through upskilling and reskilling. And I think there's an important difference there. And I think, you know, this Parliament has to be on the side of business when it comes to helping them address the barriers in the private and public sectors which restrict modernisation and which can impact on them when it comes to employment and entrepreneurship. So I will make just a brief comment to finish off, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's good news that the export side and some of the inward investment is going in the right direction, but can we set it in the context of the bigger economy and ensure that we do everything else within economic policy to enhance the progress that we're making?
Thank you, Ms Smith. I now call Daniel Johnson for around 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I think we've grown used to in recent months hearing about the cost of living emergency and the harsh reality of people's wages simply not stretching to paying their bills, the cost of their shopping and the fundamentals of life. But the stark truth is this, is that this is not an emergency that has come out of nowhere. Wages have been stagnant for a decade, a fact that the UK government seeks to ignore. But the other stark fact is the one just hinted at by Liz Smith, which is that, as the Scottish Fiscal Commission is clear, that Scottish productivity has stalled since 2015. Not my words, but theirs. That, coupled with the fact that the way the fiscal framework works, that was agreed to and indeed trumpeted at the time by John Swinney, is that when our income tax receipts grow more slowly than the UK average, we have less money to spend. So while there is good news today, those are the fundamentals. Those are the serious issues that we need to grapple with. So I welcome the opportunity to debate these things, but like others, I lament the fact that we've had no real time to digest the facts that are contained in these papers. There's nothing preventing the government sharing them under embargo. And frankly, I think it's slightly shameful to point to the Queen's death as a reason why they could not be shared. The fundamental issues and trends are those of productivity and wage growth. If you'd like to apologise, by all means.
Minister.
Accurate. What I said was that the reason there is no motion is as a consequence of the events of recent days. That's not the reason why the documents weren't published. And I've already explained, I think, three times why the documents weren't published.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm not clear that's any better. Look, I welcome the three plans from the Scottish Government because I think they do, in broad terms, deal with those issues around and how they can be tackled through exports, through capital and through inward investment. And I recognise that they're an attempt to deal with the serious and difficult issues through the need for coordinated investment underpinned by infrastructure, clarity about the need for sustained focus on skills and human capital, and that those two things are linked with investment. And finally, clarity about those things that we want to make and the services we want to provide and sell to the world. Because I think having that focus is actually fundamental and important if we are going to be successful. But overall, and I will contain myself to the plans overall because I've had no ability to engage with the results, is that there are shortcomings in those plans. Firstly, and perhaps most importantly, is that I think we have failed to learn from the lessons of the past. And these plans are overly reliant on foreign direct investment. And there is an all too familiar pattern of jobs lost through industries such as shipyards, steelworks and factories, and various administrations trumpeting replacements from overseas employers in new industries. And we can all name the electronics firms that came and went and came in the 80s only to go in the 90s and noughties, and no one talks about Silicon Glen anymore. Mistakes that I think we repeated with wind power generation because no one talks about the Saudi Arabia of wind anymore. And while ScotWind is name-checked in all of these plans, I think there's little more than the verbiage around domestic supply chain to really guarantee that those mistakes are not being repeated. So really, ultimately, what these plans fail to do is engage with how you make those investments stick, how we create the conditions where, when people invest in Scotland, they do so because this is the only place that they can make the things they want to make and do the things they want to do. But another key issue running through these plans is their lack of analysis, depth or clarity around how they are to be implemented. This is, I think, a key criticism of NSET, and it's also, I think, echoed in these plans. There is no real analysis of what has worked to arrive at this point, and therefore how we build on it, let alone what hasn't worked. I think we've had plenty of interventions from the Minister so far. And the Inward Investment Plan, I think, is much the same. There's no clarity about what the enhanced status for these down-selected industries are, clarity about what assistance they will receive. Likewise, we hear much about alignment with higher education, but little analysis of what makes our higher education sector successful or how we enhance that. There's talk about clusters, but no discussion around planning policy and things like that which hold back investment, which I hear time and time again from sectors ranging from renewables through to life sciences. Perhaps most concerningly is that the failure of these plans to draw conclusions of their own little analysis that they provide. The Inward Investment Strategy document sets out different productivity levels depending on domestic investments as compared to overseas and indeed our UK investment. Those differences can be as much as 20-50%. Without showing any analysis, the Scottish Government seems to assume it's by the virtue of that investment being foreign that it somehow improves productivity. I would suggest that it's the fact that it's actually those businesses, those enterprises, are receiving investment. And I think the very fact that there's a difference between UK investments and those domestic should be a cause of great concern, and actually underlines the underlying problem we have in terms of Indigenous domestic investment. I'll just draw to a close. I welcome focus on investment, delivering new jobs, but my fear is that we're failing to learn the lessons of the past. And if the London government is trying to reheat and revive trickle-down economics, I think this government is labouring under the outmoded idea that the only form of investment that is valuable is that that comes from overseas. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. I now call Willie Rennie again for up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm going to talk about the GFG Alliance and the Lanarkshire Steel Mills and the Lochaber Aluminium Smelter. And the Minister's laughing, but this is a very serious situation, and he has not addressed at all the substance of the matters that I'm about to cover this afternoon. Especially since we didn't receive the documents in advance, I think it's appropriate for the Minister to answer questions despite his desire to shut me up. We know that the Lanarkshire Steel Mills are owned by Liberty Steel, which is part of the troubled GFG Alliance. It was previously owned by Tata. Auditors, King and King, Minister didn't refer to this, quit recently, stating they were unable to complete audits. And I've got new information today. A new Freedom of Information request confirms ministers, including the First Minister, were told of the risks of the deal when they signed it off. These are risks that the Minister, Ivan McKee, has since avoided telling Parliament about even when we asked him directly. Let me spell this out exactly what it means. Ministers chose to throw their weight behind Liberty Steel, despite the government's top economic official writing to Nicola Sturgeon warning of very significant political, financial, state aid and legal issues, and is carrying significant state aid and financial risk because of Tata's terms. Ministers were specifically warned by their own advisers about a lack of due diligence, the risk of the untested state aid position, and the risk of not having a business case that sets out the rationale for our intervention. Ministers were warned that the government could become liable for the environmental costs. This too calls into question Ivan McKee later telling Parliament that it was not our intention to sign up to a contract clause which may not comply with state aid requirements. That's despite being warned by the top economic advisor that that's exactly what they were getting into. Ministers knew fine well this was a risk, and they were warned about it by their advisor. Tata refused to deal directly with Liberty because they didn't know enough about the company or its business plan, and they were already in a discussion with another company, Greybull. The price of Tata not selling to Greybull was for the Scottish Government to take on Tata's past and future liabilities through a back-to-back deal. Members will recall that the Scottish Government has since tried to renege on the commitment to take on the environmental liability if Liberty Steel were to collapse and the GFG alliance were unable to step in. So Tata had another buyer, and the government were warned about the state aid rules and financial risk, yet they charged ahead with a company now on the verge of collapse. And the minister doesn't think it's appropriate to fill us in on any of that detail this afternoon. All of this reveals a regardless, reckless approach from the ministers, dismissing advice and warnings and a failure to be open and straightforward with this parliament about the decisions that were taken behind the scenes. And it is the workers and the taxpayers that may pay the price. Let me turn to Lochaber Aluminium Company, Alvance, also owned by GFG Alliance. In unaudited accounts, Mr Gupta outlines material uncertainties that cast significant doubt on the company's ability to continue as a going concern. This is the top man expressing his real concern about whether the company is going to continue to be a going concern. Yet again, the minister doesn't think it's appropriate to update the chamber on his... But I've got more to come. Believe me, I've got more to come. Members will recall that Mr Gupta acquired the Lochaber plant and its accompanying hydropower station in 2016. However, documents filed at Companies House reveal that while the Scottish Government provided guarantees of up to £500 million for the deal, Mr Gupta just put in £5 towards the deal. Now the assets are worth £100 million more. The Minister's got time and he's summing up. I tell you, I've got an awful lot more to get through. Despite the flashy promises of 2,000 jobs and a new billet plant, nothing has materialised, even though the SNP Government provided hundreds of millions of pounds of financial guarantees. It's pretty clear now that the Minister and the Government were duped by the DFG Alliance. The Scottish Government must set out what will happen to the financial guarantees that it has provided. What will happen to the plant and what will happen to the... He's got time later. What will happen to the workers, most importantly? I don't have time to remind the Chamber of the issues from the failed BIFAB issue as well and the loss of millions of pounds for no return. All in all, we have a Scottish Government that is cavalier, ignores advice, uses vast sums of public funds to make political gestures rather than sound economic investment. The industrial intervention strategy is simply not working. It's about time that the government was open to the situation that it has created. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Rennie. We now move to the open debate. I call first Fiona Hislop to be followed by Douglas Lumsden for up to 6 minutes.
Presiding Officer, I will address the debate, and it's a pity that the intervention offered by the Minister was not taken by Mr Rennie. Presiding Officer, Scotland has got what it takes to be a successful country in key areas of dynamic international growth, renewable energy, digital and life sciences in particular, and we have regularly operated a trade surplus in the past, unlike the rest of the UK. We are an international partner of choice, as the Minister has set out. A strong inward investment and exporting base is important for a number of reasons. Exporting companies tend to be more innovative, productive and competitive. But trading strength is but one of a number of firm bases needed for economic transformation. As the Economy Committee pointed out in our supply chain report, we need strong Indigenous companies with secure supply chains to thrive despite the economic shocks of pandemics, EU exit and war in Ukraine. In particular, inward investment as a result of the takeover of previously owned Scottish companies is a double-edged sword, as it can in some cases diminish our Scottish-owned entrepreneurial company base. New inward investment does have benefits and brings more and more high-value jobs. Mr Johnson, that means growing Scottish income tax levels, and we have export strengths too. In my own area of West Lothian, we can count on some of the most successful examples of inward investment and export businesses. Mitsubishi Electronics with their £50 million investment announcement, Shin-Etsu in life sciences, Q2 Solutions, whose European lab services operate from Livingston, and exporters Calnex Solutions in Linlithgow, who I visited a few weeks ago, whose test instrumentation for network synchronisation has secured orders from over 600 customer sites in 68 countries across the world. Scotland's educated workforce, superb world-leading research universities, great natural energy and other capital are all areas with specific Scottish Government responsibilities for leadership. And while government can create the conditions to foster and promote success, it is the businesses that choose to invest here that will deliver economic growth from exports. But the Scottish Government does not currently hold key levers to face down the fiscal challenges and build resilience in the economy to support trading businesses. It is the UK Government which benefits from corporation tax and VAT income, but it is also responsible for the plummeting of the pound, for rising inflation, and for the collapse in the number of companies wanting to export. The UK economy has seen decades of relative decline to comparator companies, and the current state of the economy is extremely serious, with an historic low value of the UK pound. Liz Smith.
Liz Smith.
To Mrs Lupp for taking the intervention, and I agree with what she set out primarily about some of the strengths within what Scotland can achieve. Does she accept, however, that one of the great concerns for business is the fact that if Scotland moved towards an independent state, and 60% of our trade is with the UK, we would end up with a hard border between Scotland and the UK. How does that help?
So if you look at some of the issues on the exports to the UK, it's in services, it's particularly in value in terms of electricity, and if we're talking about energy security, which I'm about to come onto, there's obviously a benefit in terms of that export of our energy and electricity in terms of those issues. So these will be issues I'm no doubt the Minister will explain will be coming out in paper form from the Scottish Government in terms of setting out the current case for Scottish independence. But we have a relative decline in the UK, but that doesn't mean the Scottish Government doesn't have responsibilities either. The Scottish Government needs to drive forward integrated policy, and renewable energy must be at the heart of Scottish Government's economic policies. We will be, and already are, a magnet for international companies, but we are in danger of leeching the rewards and benefits overseas to international shareholders instead of benefiting in terms of jobs or cheaper energy, and this is likely to get worse under a Liz Truss-led UK government. The Scottish Government and the Scottish approach should look at a basis of energy security for the future. We are and can be world-leading as we build a just transition from oil and gas using skills for carbon capture, utilisation and storage and deliver renewable energy. We have the energy, but we don't have the government powers. An independent Scotland could provide energy security for individuals, energy security nationally and energy security internationally to tackle climate change and help partners to withstand hostile aggression. But we must execute this with pace and opportunity. Plans for green hydrogen exports, particularly with Germany, must be grasped and pursued with a vigour. The rapid escalation of demand we are not currently meeting in terms of development or manufacture. Instead, we've been resting on hydrogen research while other countries surge ahead. Scotland has so much potential, but its prospects are dictated by a UK decline. Indeed, OECD has just this summer forecast that the UK will deliver 0% economic growth next year, the lowest of every G20 member bar Russia. And the true measure of wealth is of the state of its populace. And it's a sign of relative decline that 63% of Ireland's poorest people have better living standards than the poorest people in the UK. Other countries have also experienced COVID disruption, the impact of Russia's war on Ukraine, but none instigated its own self-inflicted economic damage of Brexit and leaving the EU. A third of companies' reduction in exporting is beyond alarming. So, in conclusion, Presiding Officer, Scotland means business. The UK is stunting our growth potential, and if we want economic transformation and growth, then Scotland needs to be complete in its government powers for growth to generate that entrepreneurial attitude and use the energy of its peoples, talents and resources. and most importantly, use the wealth of Scotland to be rewarded, rooted and returned to the people of Scotland for the benefit of the people of Scotland.
Thank you, Ms Hislop. I now call Douglas Lumsden to be followed by Kenneth Gibson again. Up to 6 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome this unusual focus on issues that actually matter to this country. But I also have to highlight the fact that the current targets laid out by this government remain, like many others, unmet. In 2019, the SNP government published their targets for exports, and they have fallen short, missing their targets by between around 10% and 16%. The promised 50% increase in value of international exports has been consistently missed. And it's also important to note, there is no time on for interventions, and it's also important to note just where our exports are going. The rest of the UK accounted for £52 billion worth of Scotland's exports, three times larger than the EU. The rest of the UK is our largest export partner. Between 2002 and 2019, 62% of Scottish exports went to the rest of the UK, with 17% to the EU and 20% to the rest of the world. 500,000 Scottish jobs are supported by trade with the rest of the UK. That is 1 in 4, according to the Fraser of Allender Institute. And yet, this SNP Green devolved government want to put barriers in place between Scotland and the rest of the UK. A hard border with our largest trading partner is quite simply a disgrace. In contrast, the UK government is working hard to secure investment throughout the UK. In 2020, they established an office for investment to further attract foreign investment into the whole of the UK. There's no time, sorry, Minister. With other initiatives such as the High Potential Opportunities Programme and free ports to assist with the movements of goods. The UK government have launched a new trade hub in Edinburgh to attract inward investment. And through the hub, businesses are able to utilise the UK government global networks, expertise and influence to grow trade overseas. Presiding Officer, when this policy was launched, the Minister said domestic business can learn new ways of operating. Managed well, this brings opportunities across Scottish supply chains and ensures our skill system and management match global standards. I think the key phrase in all of this is managed well. Will this be as well managed as the ferry contract or the Rangers debacle? Or what about the NHS waiting times or the crisis in local government funding? The SNP Green Coalition of Chaos has no credibility or track record when it comes to managing things well. And I feel fear for the future of this policy, given so many of our core businesses and services rely on investment and exports for the future. I won't take any interventions. We got this documents about an hour before we came in here, so I'm not taking any intervention. No, you've already answered that, and it wasn't very good. I was listening, but it was a load of rubbish. When it comes to inward investment, what businesses look for is certainty and security. And the constant threat of another divisive independence referendum is driving investment away. At this time, supporting our recovery from the pandemic and helping businesses through the global cost of living crisis should be our main priority, not stoking division and dissent and creating borders where none should be. A border between Scotland and England would end the free movement of goods within Great Britain and see a trade border imposed between England and Scotland, our main trading partner. Independence is never going to happen, but the constant threat of it is harming us and driving investment away. Presiding Officer, when I was reading the investment plan last night, I did think I had missed a chapter. The oil and gas industry has been a key part of our economy and inward investment, but this devolved government seemed to want to airbrush it out of our economy. It's clear to see when you look at the table in the plan that shows wages in the North East at the top when it comes to foreign-owned firms. This is down to the energy industry. But this government seems intent on driving this investment away just to appease their green partners. While we still have a need for hydrocarbons, we should be supporting the industry in this country, not relying on imports from other countries. This is better for our jobs and better for our economy as a whole. As part of the Finance Committee, we constantly hear that we are underperforming compared to the rest of the UK. And a big part of this is because what is happening in the northeast of Scotland. But it's very clear that this government has turned its back on the industry and the North East. We've heard a lot from this government on energy transition, which greatly affects the North East, and we have had many debates about a just transition in this chamber. Given our global energy crisis. I welcome the UK government's pragmatic approach to developing domestic supplies of the fuel that we need while moving away from fossil fuels and towards sustainable energy. I know that the energy companies in the North East welcome that approach and see an energy transition as the way forward. The SNP Green government would send them off a cliff edge, making us more reliant on foreign oil and gas and less able to be self-sufficient. Their policy would be detrimental for the economy of the North East. It won't increase investment, it will decimate it. Presiding officer, in closing, I would once again ask that this Green, SNP Green government, that if they're serious about investment in Scotland and growing our exports, then don't pursue this obsession about splitting up the UK and creating uncertainty. Instead, support and work with the UK government and understand that that trading might that we have as a United Kingdom is far more than we can ever achieve if splitting from our largest partner. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I now call on Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. During the COVID-19 pandemic, the Scottish Government decided it would work to rebuild our economy in a way that is ethical, bold and aimed at sustainable growth, publishing its inward investment plan in October 2020, followed by a global capital investment plan in March last year. Together with the pre-pandemic export growth plan, these strategies give Scotland a three-pronged approach to achieving sustainable export growth. In addition, the Scottish National Investment Bank and International Trade Envoys and Offices help Scottish businesses in their efforts to secure investment and exports. According to Scottish Development International, 7,780 planned real living wage jobs were created by inward investment projects in 21-22, with 39 investors choosing Scotland for the very first time. Scotland grew 8 times faster than the UK in attracting foreign direct investment projects, while the UK as a whole had the lowest rate of business investment among the 37 countries of the Organisation for Economic Cooperation and Development, bar Greece. And the 2022 EY Attractiveness Survey shows that Scotland's perceived appeal to investors now sits at a record high, with 15.8% rating Scotland as the UK's most attractive location, up from 15% last year, and more than doubling its 7% in 2019. More than 90% of the inward investment projects are in the nine areas of opportunity identified in the Scottish Government's Inward Investment Plan, which accurately assess Scotland's needs and strengths, as well as our ability to attract the right investment. And my own constituency of Cunningham North, I'm delighted at recent investments made. At COP26, which the Minister referred to, Dutch headquartered global health and nutrition company Royal DSM announced that its groundbreaking feed additive Bovaer, which drastically reduces cattle-produced methane, a molecule with more than 80 times the warming impact of carbon dioxide, will be globally manufactured at the firm's site in Dalry and be fully operational by 2025. Dalry was chosen over dozens of other sites globally, showing the confidence DSM has in Scotland and its Ayrshire workforce. £100 million of private investment is supported by £12 million of Scottish Government support through Scottish Enterprise, which will sustain or create at least 350 high-quality, well-paid jobs, including dozens of new apprentices, who were delighted when the Minister visited just last month. Terms like foreign direct investment, inward investment and export growth sound abstract and make us think of markets rather than people. However, when I visited DSM during Scottish Apprentice Week and spoke to young employees, I was reminded how much new investment means to real people and how for many it provides them with an opportunity to enjoy a potentially well-paid, highly skilled and secure career. DSM aimed to have 119 apprentices by 2024, some of whom will work on Bovaer. This groundbreaking project has been a long-term strategic investment of Royal DSM into improving sustainability. And having Bovaer produced in Scotland allows us to make a huge contribution to the reduction of global greenhouse gas emissions from milk and beef production, and indeed sheep, as enteric methane is dramatically and consistently reduced. I've asked the Scottish Government how it intends to incentivise use of this new sustainable feed additive by Scottish farmers. Once the UK joins other countries from the Benelux to Brazil in providing regulatory approval for Bovaer, I would expect Scottish ministers will be keen to assist our farmers in providing this low-cost additive, one which is probably the most cost-effective way of reducing the impact of our emissions. Such support will surely encourage many others to buy Bovaer, impacting even more widely to limit climate change globally. Another welcome news for people keen to work in Cunningham North, an impending new project at Hunterston is expected to provide 900 jobs directly by 2024, with thousands more generated in the wider supply chain across Ayrshire and beyond. This new facility will manufacture cables for what will be the world's longest subsea infrastructure for the Morocco to UK solar power project. It almost didn't happen. Back in May, the project director of Essex-based company XLCC contacted me to say that as North Ayrshire Council's planning committee was not going to consider their planning application until August, the project could go to Teesside, where it would be considered first. I immediately contacted North Ayrshire Council's SNP leader Marie Burns and Chief Executive Craig Hatton, and that very same day they agreed to bring planning consideration forward by 8 weeks. Planning consent was granted. And this episode shows how crucial the timing of such decisions can be. It's anticipated that some employees of Hunterston B, which was closed in January, will transfer their skills, and this is inward investment aiding the just transition. We're making great progress in exports too. 3 weeks ago, I visited Dunbar Highland Meats and Salcoats, which exports 16% of its product. This state-of-the-art cattle processing facility employs 325 people on site, and what's with over 1,000 Scottish farmers, all no further than 4 hours away from Salcoats, the cattle being born and reared in Scotland to the highest standards. The Boning Hall, which represents a £12 million investment in more efficient processing, was built with the assistance of a Food Processing and Marketing Cooperation grant of £2.5 million from the Scottish Government. And another successful company, an indigenous to North Ayrshire, is the highly innovative steel fabricator John D. Pearce, founded by Jim Pearce in 1975, which now employs 425 people, the largest steel fabricator in the northern half of the UK. So it's crucial we create and sustain jobs of all skill levels across North Ayrshire and beyond, and I'm optimistic about the prospects this offers my constituents and others in the west of Scotland. I'm keen to see more companies invest where we have, in my constituency, we have plenty to offer and need to create and sustain greater levels of employment. On a national level, many will have been heartened that Scottish Development International will lead Scotland's presence at the five-day Hanover Messe Integrated Energy Expo in April next year, one of the largest events of its type in Europe, attracting over 1,800 exhibitors, with the 2019 Expo leading to £27 million of export sales from Scottish exhibitors. Next year's promises again to be a valuable opportunity. Sadly, one that the UK Government is not going to participate in. The Scottish Government also published a special export plan for tech companies which supports the specific needs and aims of Scotland's valuable technology sector, which provides 83,610 jobs with a £21.6 billion turnover. Presiding Officer, it's important we use the limited powers we have to help nurture and grow our businesses and markets, and the Scottish Government continues to do just that, looking forward and outward, and will do even more with independence.
Thank you. I now call Richard Leonard to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Mr. Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And let me begin with a few facts. We export 50% more to the rest of the UK than we do to the whole of the rest of the world put together. Fact. We export three times as much to the rest of the UK as we do to the whole of the European Union combined. Fact. Exports which are shipped via a port in England to France are classified as Scottish exports to France. Fact. These are all published in the Scottish Government's own Export Statistics Scotland. Fact. So to the nationalists who want us to break away, to set up a separate currency, to withdraw all of our democratic representative votes and voices over the political and economic direction of our biggest export market, I say, you are presenting a prospectus not for gaining control, but for giving it away. And here is another fact. We have a state investment bank that has made its biggest investment, £50 million over 5 years, not in our manufacturing base, not with a Scottish exporter of high-value services, but with the Gresham House Forestry Fund, who admit that only 60% of that investment from the Scottish National Investment Bank will be directed to Scotland. This is an asset management company whose primary business objective is not to plant trees, it's not to save the planet, it is to aid the super rich to avoid paying tax. Go and look at their website. They offer favourable income tax treatment, exemptions on capital gains tax, and 100% relief on all inheritance tax. So when the minister tells us that, and let me quote him, "Scottish Government-backed investment funds are designed to fill key gaps in the continuum of growth capital to enable Scottish companies to scale up." He must know that that's not what is going on out there in the real world. And here are some more economic facts. One worker out of every three in Scotland is now employed in a company which is owned and controlled outside Scotland. More than half of the turnover in the Scottish economy is owned and controlled outside Scotland. More than two-thirds of business research and development, over three-quarters of Scottish exports are from businesses owned and controlled outside Scotland. The Minister I know is relaxed about this, but I put it to him that this over-reliance on mobile extractive capital means that the Scottish economy is in effect entirely dependent on decisions made by a small number of financiers, speculators, landlords, capitalists in faraway boardrooms. Long-term strategic decisions on investment, on production, on jobs, on supply chain procurement, even on marketing and sales, are not made here, but they are made externally. And this has all too often meant lagging productivity, poor quality, non-union jobs, downsizing, and ultimately a heightened vulnerability to closure. And all the time while this is going on, and the Scottish Government continues to quote ad nauseam the E&Y attractiveness survey, local indigenous business development is stuck at dangerously low levels. Compassion, solidarity, a sense of common good, values so evident during the lockdown, were so scarce in our economy pre-COVID-19 that many of us vowed that we must never go back. But when I listen to the debate today, it sounds like we have. So I say to ministers, you cannot base your economic policy on being, and I quote, a magnet for inward investment, and in the next breath say you want a country where economic power and opportunity are distributed fairly. You can't have both. This is not a policy for taking back control. It's a policy for giving it away. This is not a policy for selling Scotland, as it says in this document. It's a policy for selling Scotland off. What we need, and what we have long needed, is an industrial strategy, investment-led, jobs first, people-centred, manufacturing-driven, based on democratic economic planning, which is environmentally sustainable, cooperative, built from the bottom up. We do need a redistribution of power, but towards working people. And that is not about putting a few token people on a few token boards. It's about the producers controlling more of the organisation of the production process. It's about the wealth creators controlling more of the distribution of the wealth that they create. We do need transformation, a transformation of the social and economic forces which breed poverty, inequality, class division, not merely managing the economy, but fundamentally changing the economy. That's what we need to do. And the sooner we start, the sooner we will deliver the very real economic and environmental social transformation which the people of this country are crying out for.
Thank you. I now call Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Ms. Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this vital, important debate on Scotland's inward investment and export growth plans. Scotland is leading the UK when it comes to securing foreign direct investment, in spite of the significant challenges posed by Brexit and the pandemic. Scotland is an attractive country for investors due to our highly skilled workforce, strong business networks, which are supported by regional economic advisory bodies. Our goods exports, excluding our oil and gas, increased by 5.7% from March 2020 to March 2022, while UK goods exports decreased by 2.9% in the same period. Indeed, Scotland attracted 119 inward investment projects in the year to the end of March 2022, a 29% rise from the previous 12 months, creating 4,408 new, highly skilled jobs for people here in Scotland. This shows that the approach our Scottish Government has taken to attract investment is working. People and businesses are prepared to invest in here due to our progressive, internationalist outlook compared to the insular, ideologically driven UK government. Presiding Officer, Scotland has been the most successful nation in the UK outside of London for 9 of the last 11 years and for the 7th year running in attracting foreign direct investment. That is testament to our highly qualified workforce and their exceptional skill base. Indeed, along with Edinburgh and Glasgow, my home city, Aberdeen, remains in the top 10 locations outside of London for attracting inward investment projects. Our four leading sectors are digital technology, utility supply, business and professional services, and machinery and equipment. Digital projects in Scotland increased by an impressive 73.4%, in contrast to a 7% decline in Europe and only a 7% growth in the UK overall. Scotland is now firmly established as the UK's number two location for digital projects behind London. This is welcome, and Scotland will continue to do all it can within the bounds of the devolution settlement to have a progressive approach to attracting inward investment, showing Scotland's success as we build on our record as a world leader. Presiding Officer, it would be remiss of me to discuss the success of Scotland's approach to inward investment without acknowledging the challenges we face caused by the UK government. We know Brexit is forecast to cause more harm to the economy than COVID. The Office for Budget Responsibility has forecast that the impact of Brexit on UK productivity will be worse in the long run than COVID-19, with Brexit reducing the UK's potential productivity by 4%, and that amounts to around £40 billion a year, whereas the pandemic is expected to reduce it by 2%. Indeed, recent trade statistics underline the negative impact of Scotland's forced exit from EU. Scotland's total trade with the EU was 16% lower in 2021 compared to 2019. Trade with non-EU countries fell by just 4% over the same period. Now, a London School of Economics study shows that Brexit-related trade barriers have so far driven a 6% increase in UK food prices, adding to the Tory-made cost-of-living crisis for households not only in Aberdeen Donside, but right across Scotland. If it wasn't for the Tories and Brexit, Scotland's exports would be soaring. But don't just take my word for it. We know that exports of goods to the EU from Scotland were 19% lower in 2021 compared to 2018, and that non-EU exports of goods were only 4% lower. The difference? Brexit. Trade figures continue to highlight the negative impact of Brexit on our economy and strengthens the case for Scotland to be an independent country. We will do so much better when we control our own affairs. Presiding Officer, of course, there is one potential opportunity which could really boost the economy of the North East, and it would be remiss of me not to mention it. A major regional alliance made up of Aberdeen International Airport, Port of Aberdeen, Peterhead Port Authority, and Aberdeen City and Shire Councils announced its formal bid for green freeport status for the North East. This bid, if successful, will boost gross value-added income by £7.5 billion over the next decade, and it will usher in a new era of investment, innovation, regional regeneration, and opportunities for those that need them most across North East Scotland. 30,000 highly skilled, highly paid jobs are estimated to come to the region, and I want to help make this happen. And while the Minister can't comment on any particular bid, as the Scottish and UK governments are still to determine the successful projects, I do seek assurances from the Minister that the North East bid will receive full consideration. Not only could it bring an economic boost to the North East, but it could also help the region to reach our net zero ambitions. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I again welcome this debate, welcome the progress which is being made to attract inward investment here in Scotland, and again reiterate my asks for a potential green free port for North East Scotland.
Thank you. And I now call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Rachel Hamilton. Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This debate comes at a time when the importance of energy and the global economy cannot be overstated. For some time, there has been an ambition shared by many here to make Scotland a world leader in clean energy. The opportunity is well understood. We have massive capacity for wind, significant potential for new technologies like wave and tidal, and we have, despite the failure of the UK government to support onshore wind, installed huge capacity for generation. As the need to replace Russian gas takes on geostrategic importance and the need to replace all other fossil fuels grows increasingly urgent, it is vital that we develop the capacity we have. But we have a problem. The jobs expected to come with the renewables revolution simply have not yet materialised in the Scottish economy. Partly, this is because we are shackled to a UK economy that has little interest in generating these skills and jobs in our economy. Everything we do is in the context of a UK government that aims to undermine the Scottish economy at every turn, be that through seeking a hard Brexit or failing to support renewables infrastructure investment and what a previous UK Prime Minister called green crap. No. But it is also because we have not yet grasped the significance of the new global economy. A global economy in which we cannot rely on the very efficient supply chains that have, up until now, located manufacturing in the global south. We have seen, with COVID shutdowns in China, the closure of the Suez Canal, and the Russian invasion of Ukraine, that these supply chains are something that we cannot, that we should not, have to rely on. Instead, we must identify onshore supply chains which might be less efficient in some ways, but certainly will be more reliable. We'll move from just in time to just in case. We'll get the jobs and the skills. Our economy will benefit from providing the clean, green energy that can decarbonise the electricity supply. So what is to be done? The severe shortages in chips used for electric vehicles, for computer processors, and so many other technology uses point to the need to invest in manufacturing. By bringing investment and skills to Scotland, we can create new indigenous innovation networks. And we know that Scotland has already been successful in attracting foreign direct investment over the past year, despite significant economic headwinds. But this influx has largely been into our three big cities. What about other parts of our country? Indeed, the UK's attempt to replace EU structural funds follows the same pattern, boosting performance where it already exists.
If Maggie Chapman goes and has a look at the analysis that was done in the Inward Investment Report, she'll see that the spread of inward investment is actually right across the country. And if you look at it on a proportionate basis, many, many of the regions outside of the large cities are actually leading that table. So it is a real balance.
Maggie Chapman.
I thank the Minister for that intervention, and that is heartening to hear, but it remains the case that so much investment we see follows the pattern boosting performance where it already exists, resulting in more unevenness than we need to see and we would like to see in our economy. We know that economic clusters can be more innovative with thicker job markets and can retain industries in a way that locating sole plants in isolation does not achieve. So we need to work to ensure we support the development of clusters that serve all of Scotland. We know the top four sectors that have benefited from inward investment are digital technology, utility supply, business services, and machinery and equipment. Manufacturing has seen significant investments, so we must ensure just transition and circular economy supply chains benefit from this trend. Building our expertise in areas like advanced manufacturing and data to create a manufacturing economy. This will build a virtuous circle of investment, innovation, export opportunities, and well-paid, good, secure jobs. and, of course, boosting the attractiveness of direct investment in well-being and local agri-food, we will help tackle the geographic unevenness we see in investment to date. Food poverty is a major issue on the horizon, so there is a strategic opportunity here for all of Scotland, but particularly for many of our rural areas, such as those in Aberdeenshire and Angus in my region, to create a more food-secure future for us all. On skills, our very high level of tertiary education is a strength, and things like skills passports will increase the availability and skills for local workforces, which investors look at when deciding where to go. The precarity of work offered by the fossil fuel industry can be counterbalanced by enhancing the mobility with a strategic emphasis on the areas where skills are lacking, for example, in heat in buildings, renewables, transport and storage. All of this fits with the mission-based approach we have advocated and which has, to some extent, been adopted by the Scottish National Investment Bank. And this is something that should be a mission across government. Others in this debate this afternoon have already highlighted just how important it is to have joined up thinking across not only government departments, but also across all different levels of government. On our trading relationships, there is much I want to say about how we must use these to secure the highest possible standards, workers' rights, environmental standards, animal welfare standards, and so on, not just for the benefit of consumers and communities in Scotland, but as part of our desire for Scotland to be a good global citizen. But to conclude, we must ensure that our inward investment and trading plans really do focus our investment and trading activities on supporting the kind of economy we want. Well-being and sustainability are integral, not accidental, for prosperity. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Michelle Thompson. Ms. Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Minister for the progress report received at 13:47, which is hardly time to have digested this to have been prepared for today's debate. However, I do welcome the debate today. And I think everybody in the Chamber would agree with me that creating jobs and exporting Scottish goods across the world is a positive goal for any government to have. And we may disagree on how to go about it, but I'm pleased to be able to speak in today's debate, which focuses on the goals that we all share. Scotland has around 11,000 export businesses, which are successful across the world. And my constituency in the Borders plays host to many of those businesses, from our world-famous weavers based in Hoyk and Selkirk, supplying textiles to fashion houses in Milan and New York, to fantastic cattle farmers in the Borders, supplying beef and dairy to supermarkets just over the border in Berwick-upon-Tweed. And engaging with these businesses regularly is one of my duties as an MSP. It paints a clearer picture of where businesses have concerns and how things like inflation impact on their plans for the future. And the Scottish Government's plans for the trading nation, I believe, do not entirely focus on the whole of Scotland. It is yet another example, I believe, of a central belt focus, government leaving rural areas behind and not focusing specifically on the issues and challenges that we face in places like the Borders. And in his closing, I would like the Minister to address these specific points that I will make during my contribution. We know that rural areas are depopulating. Scotland's population is ageing. There are a higher number of retirees in the Borders, for example, which is driving economic inactivity. And skilled workers are just not being replaced. Wages in the Borders are £3,000 below the Scottish median, and 9% of workers are earning below the living wage, with the gender gap, pay gap, being four times greater than the Scottish average. And there is a sense of deep frustration in areas like my constituency and other rural areas of my colleagues across Scotland, a sense that despite the enormous contribution that Scotland's rural economy makes to our country, they are simply being ignored. And in many cases, it seems that rural businesses are not only being ignored, but the Scottish Government is unable to just grasp the nettle to deal with depopulation and to boost the housing stocks, which are key drivers for businesses to attract investment and growth. We know that the food and drink sector accounts for around 10 billion of Scotland's overall exports. The industry employs over 100,000 people, yet it is hamstrung by the inability to be able to drive innovation under this government's policy, an anti-scientific political rhetoric from this government and the Greens. Whilst farmers in England will look forward to forging ahead with the use of gene editing technology to increase their yields, to protect crops, to increase biodiversity, to help them with the threat of disease and drought, Scottish farmers will be left behind due to this intransigent position of aligning with Europe and the hated CAP regime. The Scottish Government have brought a debate on export growth plans to this chamber at a time when Putin's invasion of Ukraine is harming global food security, but their intransigence fails to see the absurdity in the position that they are taking on gene editing. Research and development, as I have said, is absolutely key to scaling up businesses, driving inward investment and exports. But you know, the expenditure, for example, in the borders per head is on R&D is just £60 per head, compared to £258 per head in the rest of Scotland. Scotland, across Scotland, every business needs the tools, all the tools in the box that they can get their hands on to take advantage of innovation in order to drive the investment. If you're quick, Jim Fairley.
The point you just made about the Scottish Government aligning with the EU, given the fact that the UK Government are clearly telling us that there's not going to be an American trade deal, would it not be better for the UK Government to align with the EU as well?
I think you're missing the entire point here. I mean, the Scottish Government in itself is missing its own biodiversity targets. It's missing its own environmental targets. This is one way of not only driving innovation and investment, this is one way of helping farmers address the challenges that they're facing head on and the environmental targets that they have to meet right now. My colleagues have discussed the impact of uncertainty on Scottish businesses. As we've already heard, the latest available data shows that the value of Scotland's exports to the rest of the UK is £42 billion. One of the most common concerns I hear from businesses in my constituency is the fear of constitutional grievance, on top of all the other concerns they have, such as rising energy costs. For businesses close to the border, where cross-border trade is absolutely fundamental to their future, they must have the confidence that they can invest and grow without this constitutional upheaval. And while some of the report today I welcome and it's good news, we do need to look at the bigger picture. As my colleague Liz Smith highlighted, the Scottish Borders is falling behind in productivity, reducing opportunities for shared prosperity. GVA per job in the south of Scotland was 70% of the national figure in 2019. The Borderlands Inclusive Growth Deal, a shared investment between the Scottish and UK government, has put shared prosperity at its heart. And when both governments work together, it creates jobs, it allows opportunity for local people, and it allows them to take part in a better quality of life and well-being. And furthermore, in the borders, people are less likely to attain higher levels of skills, which Daniel Johnson talked about skills. 7% fewer people in the borders holding a degree level qualification versus the Scottish average. And to drive investment, once again, I want to emphasise that point that we want to see people, skilled people, living and working in rural areas and stemming that widening employer and workforce skills gap. And to conclude quickly, Presiding Officer, I just want to say that the government must place rural regions at the heart of their economic plans. We need to look at the catalogue of the broken promises on skills, shortages, attracting inward investment and addressing productivity issues in rural areas. But finally, they've got to drop their reckless ambition to break up the United Kingdom. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Hamilton. And I now call Michelle Thompson, who will be the last speaker in the open debate before I move to winding up speeches. Ms Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The William of Aberdeen vessel sailed across the Atlantic in 1596 in the first recorded Atlantic trade ship from Scotland to what is now known as Newfoundland. Long before that, Scotland already had trading links with our much closer neighbours in Europe. Our trading history has fundamentally shaped who we are. In the 18th century, Adam Smith would walk along the bank of the River Forth and gaze at the great trading ships of the day taking goods and people to other lands. This inspired Smith too to consider the positive benefits of international trade. Some Tories today haven't appeared to notice that the shock of a Tory Brexit and decimation of exports to mainland Europe. HMRC data confirms the number of businesses exporting goods to the EU falling 33% in 2021 compared to 2020. And of course, to make matters worse, Liz Truss has confirmed it will take years to negotiate a trade deal with the USA, and we have the paltry trade deal with Australia that directly harms our farmers. So perhaps the trailing from the UK government of removing the cap on banker bonuses tells its own story about where their priorities lie. I therefore want to thank the Minister for his good work thus far, and I note that Scotland's the only part of the UK with a positive trade balance in goods with the rest of the world. And I look forward to reading the progress reports released today, although I would add my voice to the lateness of their arrival, which I regret. So in this speech, I'm going to focus on international trade in the present day and also in the Scottish diaspora. Some of the early diaspora that Smith watched leave their homeland and find new opportunities, particularly in Americas, resonates with me. A few years ago, I undertook research into Scotland's business diaspora. We collected views from over 1,000 business leaders in 74 countries, and it presented a clear picture of Scotland and also what could be done to support international trade. Amongst many findings, Scotland was seen as friendly, resilient, and entrepreneurial. However, there was also a significant minority view that pointed to a cautious, risk-averse, and inward-looking community. Scottish business people were largely viewed positively too, with key characteristics such as ethical, hardworking, and well-educated, while some critics thought we were too inward-looking. Put simply, in terms of the Scottish brand, the quality of our people was prominent in comments, and I was pleased to see the mention, active consideration and modern development of our brand called for years ago by Murray Pittock. In this regard, our universities and colleges have had a pivotal role in developing our people and in enablement of an outward-focused entrepreneurial export sector. So can I therefore ask the Minister what recent discussions he's had to ensure the university and college sector continue to contribute to our export-focused and entrepreneurial-focused cultures, which are more than just the passing over of skills, of course. Returning to the research, I mentioned that there's also a strong perception that the Scottish diaspora is insufficiently mobilised, whilst many stated a willingness to help if asked. I therefore recognise the mobilisation of the diaspora highlighted in the progress report and the increase in the number of global Scots alongside the digital system that's been put in place. However, development capacity in all its forms takes time, and I wonder if the Minister, in his summing up, could give further flavour to his capacity building plans, either directly through the Scottish Government or via their partner agencies. I regret that Scotland's lost some of its capacity for direct exporting today. Too many of our goods are having to pass through England before moving on to export markets. Now, I know it can't be sorted overnight, but perhaps future iterations of the Trading Nation or some other document will consider wider infrastructure rather than just supply chain requirements to build and embed resilience and enable international trade, although I recognise the constraints on capital expenditure, particularly just now. I've had meetings with Marco Forgione, the Director General of the Institute for Export and International Trade. His thoughts regarding developing a full mentoring service, including technical support from trade specialists, tapping into our business diaspora, creating specialist advice lines so that business can access timely advice and support. And much of this, I'm delighted to see, is already included in the progress report, so it saves me suggesting them to the Minister, although it might be worthwhile the Minister meeting him too if he hasn't done so already. So I therefore commend in particular the outstanding work of Ivan McKees. He made tremendous efforts to get a focus on international trade and championing the Scotland a Trading Nation report, all the activity that goes along with it and its subsequent progress report. I'm delighted to see that under his direction, Scotland continues to be an outward-looking trading nation. Thank you.
Thank you. And we will now move to winding up speeches. I call on Paul Sweeney on behalf of Scottish Labour to wind up the debate. 6 minutes, please, Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It has been an interesting debate, despite the difficulty in fully digesting quite substantial documents within such a short period of time, which was unfortunate. However, I think we've been able to glean some useful characteristics across the chamber. I think there's been a shared sentiment from members speaking today that we want Scotland to fulfil its full economic potential. We want our people to be prosperous and we want to build prosperity in our country. But there was a bit of a disconnect between the rather bombastic claims made by the Minister in his opening remarks and the preceding statement and questions from the Deputy First Minister, where we were faced with severe economic headwinds that threaten the prosperity of our country. There are difficulties and structural problems in the Scottish economy cannot help but be factored into this. And I don't feel that this report is in any way going to help us fundamentally shift that. There are some interesting points made, but the fundamental issue is it's passive in the nature of the challenges we face. It is too passive in the nature of the challenges we face. Since 2014, Scottish GDP growth, have to take an intervention.
Minister.
What isn't in the report that the member would like to see us have in there with regard to driving export growth and driving inward investment growth? And does he not accept that significant results we've achieved over the last 2 to 3 years are testament to the fact that these action plans are absolutely right on the money when it comes to doing what needs to be done to further drive Scotland's success in these areas?
Paul Sweeney.
Well, if they were right on the money, then we wouldn't be facing these significant revenue challenges, nor would we be undershooting our export growth targets, which are massively ambitious and are not simply on the trajectory of the curve we need. And a good example is action number 4 on the inward investment plan. It talks about identifying, practically targeting 50 leading global companies we want to attract to Scotland. Why doesn't it talk about building 50 world-leading companies in Scotland? It doesn't mention that idea. It doesn't look at building wealth and capacity in Scotland. I'm afraid that the time is against me, Minister. I will endeavour to bring you in at a suitable juncture, but I want to develop some of my arguments first of all. We do have good advantages in Scotland. For example, economic development spending is higher in Scotland than anywhere else in the UK. Indeed, it's 60% higher than UK average. But unfortunately, that higher spending isn't feeding into better productivity or growth because there's too much of a quick turnover and churn and lack of focus in investment strategies. And as an alumni of Scottish Enterprise, I can attest to that at first hand. It wasn't an organisation that was fully geared up to building the kind of capabilities we need in Scotland. And that's because it's too passive. I've seen it firsthand. For example, let's look at some of the issues we've dealt with. The Minister will be well aware of, for example, the recent closure of the Cali Rail Works in Springburn, just next to his constituency. Let's look at that as a case study. When it was bought over by Mutares, a German firm, that would have been counted as inward investment, lauded according to the Minister, because all inward investment is great. But actually, what was the inward investment about? It was debt loading Scottish-owned assets. It was flogging the real estate off to real estate investment trusts overseas, based in New York. And then it was asset stripping those industries from Scotland to service the debts, to focus on the actual intellectual property, which was held by the English subsidiary, not in Scotland. So the Scottish subsidiary was thrown away. And now we have 163 years of railway engineering in Scotland destroyed because of inward investment that was actually predatory in nature, not developmental in nature. That is why we can't simply look at FDI and think it's a panacea. That's what my friend Richard Leonard was alluding to when he was talking about the extent to which the Scottish economy is increasingly characterised by becoming a branch plant. When we see stories, for example, McVitie's, a Scottish company, having had its ownership stripped from the country and centred now on Turkish ownership, and at the last factory with the McVitie's brand closed down in Glasgow, and losing that brand that's so synonymous, one of the best Scottish brands globally. Would America allow Coca-Cola to go the same way? I don't think so. So we have to fundamentally focus on how we retain and build Scottish wealth in this country. And it would be things around looking at where we are world leaders and have potential to be world leaders, and building the companies in Scotland, building it with the Scottish Investment Bank, taking those stakes, building that equity, but ensuring the predatory overseas takeovers are prevented. That would be the fundamental ethos at the heart of a strategy like this. But unfortunately, when it comes to that kind of thing, it is thoroughly silent. And I think members on the government benches, I think Fiona Hislop, member for Linlithgow, mentioned that as well, her concern that Scotland is too vulnerable to overseas takeovers. And we've all got stories, I'm sure, where we've seen great Scottish potential thwarted by overseas takeovers. And wouldn't it be great to see Scottish businesses going out into the world and buying over other companies and building that global network with the control and capability headquarters in our cities, rather than it being located in boardrooms in other countries? And I think rather than Scottish Enterprise and Scottish Development International going around begging other boardrooms in other countries to invest in Scotland, we could actually take up the bull by the horns ourselves and do the hard work that's needed. But I don't think that the agencies are doing that well enough. And that needs to be a fundamental challenge back to them to up their game and stop this neoliberal passiveness. For example, when the suggestion came up about emulating the Mondragon concept in Spain, let's build the railway engineering in Springburn. Let's allow the employees to take ownership of the assets there. Let's build, along with a new publicly owned railway company, a centre of excellence for railway engineering in Scotland. I was looked at like I had two heads. It just didn't compute with their thinking at all economically, fundamentally. And we see the same in issues such as mentioned by Willie Rennie at Liberty Steel. Fundamentally, could have been at the heart of a renewable renaissance. Green steel, rolling plates, electric arc furnaces, we could have been all that stuff. What are we doing now? Dealing with another distressed company on the brink of collapse. Same with Ferguson Marine, long-term investment plan, long-term procurement plan. CIMAL isn't interested. We're sending orders to Turkey. All of these things are fundamentally at odds with each other. And unless we get it all shaken out and get it right, which we all desperately want, then we're not going to achieve these gains needed to help us fund our public services. And we're going to continue to have the Deputy First Minister coming in here and making cut after cut to our public services.
Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. I now call on Jamie Halkrill-Johnson to wind up on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr. Halkrill-Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's welcome that the Scottish Government has brought forward this debate today at a time of unprecedented strain on our businesses. Many across the country are struggling. They face additional costs, although the help announced today and over the last few weeks by the UK Government will be welcome. But above all, they are still emerging and recovering from 2 years of a pandemic. This is an unprecedented time in our history and calls for a serious approach from governments everywhere. So I was disappointed with the National Strategy for Economic Transformation earlier this year, which was generally considered thin gruel for business. Introducing the strategy, Kate Forbes promised a ruthless focus on delivery and that the government would be judged on the outcomes we deliver, not for the strategy we write. But these fine words will only be realised by ministers meeting those commitments. And so it's disappointing that the delivery plans for the 5 programmes for action were not published by the 1st of September date as promised. We face challenges like never before, and the economy will be central to how we weather the years ahead, how we maintain jobs, and how we ensure the living standards of our constituents. The UK has long been a global and European leader in attracting inward investment, and Scotland punches above its weight in that regard too. This is testament not only to Scotland's attractiveness as a destination, but to the quality of work to promote Scotland that is done on our behalf. From its origins as located in Scotland, SDI has a commendable record of bringing investment. But of course, it is far from the only organisation looking towards trade and investment in Scotland. The new on-the-ground presence of the Department for International Trade, just down the road at Queen Elizabeth House, is extremely welcome and will hopefully drive further positive working relationships between the Department and SDI. We recall particularly the conclusions of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee in 2015, which observed that coordination between SDI and UKTI, one of DIT's predecessors, was not as strong as it could be. The Deputy First Minister was, at that time, optimistic about the role of collaborative working and the importance of getting the right services to business to trade internationally and to locate their businesses in Scotland. And I'm more than happy to echo those sentiments today because, as my colleague Liz Smith said earlier, both the Scottish Government and the UK Government should be working together in these areas, despite their political differences. There should be a shared ambition for Scotland and one of positive and sustainable economic growth, although I appreciate that's not necessarily what the SNP's new Green colleagues in government support, but hopefully more sensible heads will prevail. It is regrettable then that the economy portfolio, including the enterprise bodies that work to support business, have often been the first casualties of this Scottish Government's cuts. We have at least seen a positive example recently of the sort of intergovernmental cooperation I've spoken about, and it was good to see the First Minister visiting the British Embassy in Copenhagen, which hosts the SDI's Danish operation, both of Scotland's governments sharing resources and knowledge for our benefit. Across the world, in fact, many of these offices are co-located within British embassies and high commissions, benefiting, I'm sure, more than just from pooling the rent and the electricity bills. We will also hope to see further work on green free ports, which have the opportunity to drive trade and investment, particularly in my own region, the Highlands and Islands. Their creation has lagged behind those announced in England, which is regrettable. But it's clearly a proposal that has captured the imagination of business in our region. One area that has been little discussed, but Paul Sweeney raised, is the nature of inward investment. Not every pound of investment is equal. And we should ask whether we are seeing jobs emerge in Scotland as a result, what the wider impact on local, regional and Scottish economy is from investments. This is an appropriate consideration. Inward investment should be beneficial not only to local employment, but also to local supply chains. But this sort of deeper analysis is largely lacking in the Scottish Government's figures. And so too with the international offices. We know they are operating, but what analysis is made of their success? What are they getting right? And what value are they adding? And of course, there is a broad recognition that Scotland and the UK more generally have suffered from relatively poor productivity. And here innovation can be vital. It's a key driver of sustainable growth and also vital in streamlining operations across the public sector. While significant work has been undertaken, particularly with the support of universities, to boost innovation in Scotland, there remains a lack of leadership in embedding innovation across both the public and private sectors. Phase one of the Enterprise and Skills Review of 2016 observed a need to review, streamline and simplify the innovation support ecosystem, connecting programmes, funding and delivery mechanisms. However, since that time, support and encouragement for innovation has arguably become even more cluttered, sitting across multiple agencies, including Scottish Enterprise, Highlands and Isles Enterprise, South of Scotland Enterprise, the Scottish Funding Council, the Scottish National Investment Bank, as well as the Scotland Can Do programme. There is work being done in this area. In June 2020, the Scottish Government's call for evidence in the new 10-year innovation strategy closed. And in July of last year, the UK Government released a new innovation strategy, noting, while this strategy applies to the whole of the UK, it also sits alongside important work being taken forward by the devolved administrations, recognising a need for collaboration, but also for specific action from the devolved bodies. The Scottish Conservatives have consistently supported a more active role in encouraging innovation. Our policy paper, Power Up Scotland, published in September 2020, advanced the argument for greater innovation spending and increased direct support for innovation. But we must also ensure that spending is directed in a positive and structured way, that value for money can be assured and that support can be accessible but also remain results-driven. We need to see a more streamlined approach to innovation, one which provides a key point for encouraging innovation within the public sector, but also more accountability and spend. And it's vital that we get the support for business right and ensure that public money that is used to encourage business growth and location in Scotland is achieving the best value possible for every pound spent. We've seen several examples of where that's fallen short. In my own region, as Willie Rennie has highlighted, the investment in the Lough Arbour smelter has failed to live up to its promise, either in terms of money invested or jobs created. And in these cases, we have seen very little accountability with the Scottish Government's role and much of their work hiding behind the cloak of commercial sensitivity. Yeah. And yet still the Minister claims he has no concerns over the deal. I hope he will address the issues that Willie Rennie raised in his summing up. Presiding Officer, we must ensure that Scotland remains an attractive place to work and to invest, that we have a streamlined and transparent approach to support, and above all, we must ensure that we use all the resources available to us, including the ability to work effectively with partners in the UK Government and its agencies. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Halkirk-Johnson. And I now call on Minister Ivan McKee to wind up on behalf of the Scottish Government. Up to 9 minutes, please, Minister.
9 minutes. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And before I start on the substance of my closing remarks, and there is a lot to cover, so I'll get through it as quickly as I can. I think it's important to draw a line under some of the comments that have been made already about the lack of motion today and the publication timing today. In particular, frankly, I'm disappointed one member who has accused me of being shameful because of my behaviour this afternoon, my comments I've made of hiding behind the Queen's death, and in fact of there not being a motion today. That policy has been agreed at the Bureau by all members, and including the Labour member, Neil Bibby. So the member that applies to may want to apologise through the course of this debate, and I'd happily take his intervention to do that if he feels so inclined. Okay. Thank you for making that clear, your position on that. So, to the substance of the debate, it's been an interesting debate. I have to say some members have been very positive about Scotland's success in this in regard of what we've delivered in terms of export growth and inward investment. Some members, unfortunately, couldn't bring themselves to accept that Scotland could be successful at anything, and I think that talks more about their attitude to Scotland and Scotland's economy and how much they care about Scotland than anything else. Liz Smith, I have to say, opened up extremely well, and to be honest, Jamie Halkett-Johnson's closing speech as well, recognising and welcoming the significant progress that we've made and highlighting some areas that we can do better on, and that's hugely welcome. I just want to touch on some of those. Liz Smith mentioned supply chain disruption without mentioning Brexit, which I thought was an interesting omission, given that's the main driver. I've not got a lot of time, but I'll try and get you in later, but I've only got a few minutes left. An interesting omission. Likewise, on population. Yes, we have a declining population, and again, Brexit, the primary cause of that situation. Interesting data point, I think Liz Smith should go and reflect on. Scotland every year attracts more working age people from the rest of the UK than leave Scotland to go and live and work in the rest of the UK. In fact, that net inward migration to Scotland from the rest of the UK is about 35,000 over the last 5 years. Testament to the fact that people from the rest of the UK do want to come and live and work in Scotland because of what Scotland has to offer in so many regards. And our comments about UK cooperation, believe you me, we try to cooperate as much as we can with the UK government. The reason there's no Greenport announcement yet isn't because of us. We've been ready for weeks. It's because of the inaction, incoherence and lack of focus from a UK government down south over quite a period of time now through the summer. And likewise, on the cost of living crisis, the Deputy First Minister has made it very clear what we asked the UK government to do. They've been very late to the table on that as we waited for the change of government for many weeks, and that's been disappointing. Daniel Johnson, frankly, has been struggling to find something sensible to say. He's been all over the place on this, and it's been quite disappointing, because usually he's much more focused and coherent in his interventions. He doesn't recognise the fact that this document is absolutely jam-packed full of analysis which focuses on what we should be delivering on. He doesn't recognise what's been delivered as a consequence of the strategy. And his comments about shipyards, commercial shipyard is still in the Clyde because of the actions taken by this government. He talks about Silicon Glen. Let me tell you, I worked through Silicon Glen. I was in Silicon Glen. I got made redundant from a business in Silicon Glen. That was under a Labour UK government and a Labour government in this chamber as well. So don't talk to me about government not being focused on supporting industry and preventing redundancies being made. He talks about the Saudi Arabia of wind. We are absolutely focused on delivering the renewable potential of Scotland, up to 40 gigawatts of offshore and onshore wind. Indeed, just this afternoon, I was on a call speaking to businesses and investors and governments in Germany virtually to impress upon them the importance of Scotland's hydrogen offering and what we can do to support their requirements in that regard. And next week I'll be in Hamburg to do exactly the same. Willie Rennie, not much to say. The member for shutting smelters, frankly, we're round and round the houses on this. The jobs have been saved. The plant is still there. If it was up to Willie Rennie, it'd be shut by now. Scottish Government is receiving all the money that's due to it. And we are have a liability that's more than covered by the asset that we can call on in the event of anything happening to that business. Just on BIFAB, Harland and Wolff, since he took over BIFAB, it's now employed 400 people as a consequence. Fiona Hislop very clearly laid out that Scotland's got what it takes through the businesses and the sectors that Scotland enjoys great strengths in, and of course highlighted the impact of Brexit and the damage that that's done to Scotland's economy. Douglas Lumsden, again, another member that I've only got 4 minutes and I've got still half of the members to get through. Douglas Lumsden, another member that can't bring himself to recognise the fact that Scotland has been successful, and another member that didn't take any interventions. I took several in my first in my opening speech. Again, Brexit driving much of the problems there. In terms of productivity, we've closed. I'll give you in 1 minute. Scotland has closed the productivity gap with the rest of the UK over the last 15 years, significant improvement. We've got the lowest unemployment consistently across the rest of the UK. Why are investors coming in Scotland to such numbers if they were so concerned about independence? You see that as an opportunity. That's one of the reasons why Scotland is leading the rest of the UK outside of London in terms of attracting inward investment. Liz Smith.
Liz Smith.
I'm grateful, Minister. Can we just address this point about Brexit, which you've mentioned time and time again? People in this chamber know what my views are about Brexit. It has happened. We have to deal with it. But can he explain where the logic is within the SNP, who are always moaning about this wonderful problem that we've had because of Brexit, but the same thing, the same thing, you're wanting to split up the UK, which has 60%, and would cause just as much and more trouble than it would be with Brexit. And your own advisers agree with that.
Minister.
I'm glad that Liz Smith recognises the damage that Brexit has done to Scottish and the UK economy. And she asks, what can we do about Brexit? Well, I'll tell Liz Smith and the rest of the Tories and the rest of the Better Together coalition what we can do about Brexit. Scotland's going to become a normal, independent country and join normal international relationships and escape from the damage that the UK government is doing to Scotland's economy and take our place as a normal, independent European country. Kenny Gibson, as always, made great focus on the success of businesses in North Ayrshire, many of which I had the pleasure of visiting recently, both in terms of inward investment successes and in terms of export successes, and makes a very important point that Scottish Government will be at Hanover Messe next year representing the Scottish economy. The UK Government has declined to attend. Richard Leonard, I don't know where to start. I mean, I start on a positive note because we are all agreed that we want inward investment here that has value to Scotland's economy. That is why values is such a central focus and absolutely core to our approach. We all agree that we want inward investment that delivers and builds in our globally leading clusters and supports local businesses as a consequence. And if you're a local business in a sector and an inward investment investor comes and parks themselves next door, you've got access to global technology, to global talent, to export markets as a consequence of that, and it builds and strengthens that cluster. So inward investment, if it's the right inward investment, which is absolutely what we're focused on, and the plan is very, very clear on that, supports local businesses to grow and prosper as a consequence of that. And there are many Scottish businesses, there's a point raised by other Labour members, Scottish businesses like Wood, like Weir, and many, many others that have grown from Scotland and have gone internationally and acquired as a consequence, and that is very much the case. That's a two-way street. Countries that trade and invest internationally are more successful, and we are very focused on making sure that inward investment
Minister,
that comes
you've
in here
30
is
seconds
here
left,
for
Minister, 30
the right
seconds.
Reasons. I don't have time to go through everybody else's contribution. I think the rural point that Rachel Hamilton made is very important. Have a look at the regional aspects of this. There's a huge focus on that. I work very closely with Sosie, who are doing a great job in terms of supporting rural investment, and my tours down there recently saw some great businesses. So rest assured, we are hugely focused on that. But just to finish, I think this debate has shown that in the work of the report, Scotland has great strengths across a whole range of global leading sectors of now and of the future. We're clearly focused on what those sectors are, but clearly focused on delivering Scotland's potential. Our innovation strategy, which has been mentioned, which will be delivered in the next few weeks, will further take that analysis and that focus to the next level. Scotland's got what it takes, but the only way we can realise the full potential of Scotland's economy is for Scotland to become a normal, independent country. Thank you very much, President.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate on delivering economic transformation, Scotland's inward investment and export growth plans. It is now time to move on to the next item of business. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 5998 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. I call on George Adam, Minister, to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak on the motion. The question is, therefore, that motion 5998 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of 6 Parliamentary Bureau motions. I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move motions 5999 and 6000 on approval of SSIs, 6001 on committee substitute, and 6002 to 6004 on designation of lead committees. Minister.
All moved, Presiding Officer.
The question on these motions will be put at decision time. There is one question to be put as a result of today's business. I propose to ask a single question on 6 Parliamentary Bureau motions. Does any member object? The question is, therefore, that motions 5999 and 6000 on approval of SSIs, 6001 on committee substitute, and 6002 to 6004 on designation of lead committees be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed, and that concludes decision time. We will now move on to the next item of business after a brief pause, and I would ask those members who are leaving the chamber to please do so quickly and quietly. Thank you.